don't know how you go through it when you're going to speak after my young brother, fellow. And after people have eaten, when they're supposed to be sleeping. Mine, I think I was given up to 30 minutes. That's very good. I'll speak fast enough. For me, let me start by most sincerely thanking the organizers of this event. And thanking all of you who have sacrificed to be here. That means, I know we're talking about investment. When I was invited to this event, I don't know the people, I've never met them, have I met Ken, have I met anybody? And I recall my wife asking me, Peter, must you go to everywhere they invite you? And I said, they're Nigerians. Maybe if I go there, maybe you'll convert one. Because what we need now. Coincidentally, I was invited for a speaking engagement at Yale University, which I did on Thursday, on the issue of Africa. And it came at the right time because we have just been nicknamed shithole. Yes. That is a statement that I feel a lot of us here feel bad about. That all Africa has been so used in that degrading manner. We have been reduced to that and everything. But as a philosopher, I always tell people, whenever people talk to me in a manner that I feel bad, I go into my shelf and reassess and re-examine myself.
Amen.
Unexamined life is not worth living. Why would anybody prefer people from Norway against people from Africa? That is the question. Because you say, why don't we have people from Norway than Africa? They ask me that in Yale. And I ask myself, it's very simple. Norway has 1 trillion sovereign wealth fund, and their per capita is $70,000. And that of Africa is $2,000. It's a simple thing. It's for Africans to go back. I've listened to Fela. Wonderful, I'm sure you get more from them. Bruce, and doing and everybody. But what question I ask myself, and you see our country today, where it is and everything, everybody saying how we're going to change it. Let's ask ourselves, how did we get here? That is the question. How did we arrive at this juncture where we're not being talked about in this manner? We don't have agitation. Boko Haram. Hesman. Also agitations from everywhere. Whether it's in the east, in the west, everywhere. And I can tell you it's gonna worsen. This is what you have when you have. It is cumulative effect of leadership failure over the years.
Yes.
And it's not gonna stop. Because you have millions of your people. I was just talking to somebody this morning. I said, listen, people are protesting in Iran. They're not protesting in Nigeria. But people don't know that the protest will come. If Iranians can protest, Iran has a GDP of 400 billion. With 79 million people, their per capita is $6,050. And they are protesting. Nigeria, per capita is 2,000. So the person with 6,000 is protesting. We're not. Iran generates 74,000 megawatts of electricity. We generate 4. And they're protesting. Iran has the unemployment of 11% and youth unemployment of 25%. We have unemployment of 19.8% and youth unemployment of 61%. So those youths will protest one day. Those of us who happen to be lucky to live in Ukraine, Victoria, and I said to them every day, if we don't look for food for those who live in Nigeria only. Because one day we will not So my people, what you need to do is, I believe that you must invest in Nigeria, you must bring your investment. What else can you do? Well, above all, for last request is most critical. We must change the mindset of Nigeria. And someone asks, how about your life? You ask that question. You know why I ask that question? Nigeria has become a case of where lunatics took over the asylum. And we know what lunatics do when you want to take anything back from them. They create a thing as if there's a war. So you run away. The madman goes there. Say, hey, I don't want to. That's what they're doing. We need to take it back. We need to become as mad as they are. They can't manage it. You have a critical problem. The managers of your country, I'm not talking about president or governor, anybody. Fella hit it. The lower people, none of you know who is in your local government. Every local government in Nigeria receives 100 million naira every month. Go and look for their chairman, they are nowhere to be found. And the same thing goes with your state. You have a situation today where people are owing salaries for 7 months and they're celebrating their birthday. How can you say a thing like that? How can you be celebrating when you've ruined people's lives? People are dying, and you're celebrating, and people are watching it on TV. It's a crisis. And the only people that can stop that crisis is you.
Yes.
They can't stop it. It's telling people in lunch that when I found it amazing that even people in America are part of the problem. As governor, I come here, you know what people tell me? This man bought this house. Why are you going to buy a house? Why would I buy a house in America? I don't give you the money. I'm going to come here and go. Why would I buy a house? Americans should live in America. I'm a Nigerian. I live in Norwich. I go to South Africa. I go to everywhere. I say, buy a house in South Africa. How many South Africans are bought houses in Nigeria? How many Americans are bought houses in Nigeria? So why do Nigerians come here? You live here, yes, you can own a house, yes. But not people. I come here as governor, and Nigerians will tell you, oh, let's bring somebody and have a party. Why will I leave Nigeria to come and do party here? No way! I should come here as a beggar for you to give me something to take home, not to come and celebrate here. I have people who need food in the country.
Thank you.
And Nigerians are celebrating here. And you go there and become the universalist. When you should push them to go back and do their work at the government. So, if your governor comes here or local government chairman, do not be part of celebrating him. Tell him to go home and fix what he's supposed to do. Don't encourage him to waste his resources. He didn't come with his money. He came with your money. We're asking you to bring back your own. What we need to do is to manage that which is there effectively. Your country, to tell you how bad your country has gone. In 1980, Nigeria as a country had a foreign reserve of $10.5 billion. China is 10. South Korea, that somebody mentioned here, is 3. 3 billion. The country was far bigger than South Korea. It had more money than China. China had a population of today, China population is 1,317,000,000. Nigeria is only 186 million. But what is happening today? China has been savings. 3 trillion, and we have 30. We have 10. They have 10. We have 10.5. They have 10. Today they have 3 trillion. We have 30. 1% of what they deserve. Today, South Korea's savings is 400 something billion, and we have 30. What went wrong here? And I can show you nations on nations. We are supposed to be part of the so-called us of nations. Now they have put us to mint nation. We're supposed to be that mint nation. Because we miss where we're supposed to be, where China, everybody is. They said we are not part of BRICS nation. They put South Africa instead. Why did they put South Africa? I'll ask that question. You don't have the infrastructure. You don't have what it takes. But look at the big nations that we've been put into. If you look at the four big nations, it's Mexico, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Turkey. Look at our look at our GDPs. Ours is not even half of the list. The GDP of Mexico, which is not there, that they call anything, is 1.3 trillion. Mexico has today savings, their debt is about 170. Of course, you can go there, but inflation, unemployment, everything is under 10%. Their market capitalization is over 400 billion. Indonesia, which has more population than us, region of 250, has 1 trillion GDP. At $110 billion in reserve. And of course, can go, their market is over 400. Market capitalization of their stock market is over 400. Turkey, which is smallest among the 80 million people, has 895 billion GDP. Their reserve is over 100 billion. Nigerian GDP is 400 billion. And on top of it, our government has the most wasteful people in charge of the world. We're in the state of Florida. This state has a GDP of $793 billion. That is twice the GDP of Nigeria. Your richest state in America is California, with a GDP of 2.6 trillion, six times Nigerian GDP. With a per capita of 50,000, Nigeria is true. Can governor of California drive 5 vehicles at a time? No, I'm asking you a question. So we need to fix this. Can governor of California use 5 vehicles at a time?
No.
In your place, they will start a college company. If it's not madness, tell me what it is. I think madness is when someone doesn't have a clue. No, there's something from madness. That's what we need to fix first. So I want you to be part of that change agency. Let people have souls and care for their people. That is what we need in our country. We need people who can think. How did China change? What happened to China? How did they change? Even in just in the year 2000, China had been able to build from year 2000 to move from go and check their GDP in the year 2000 was just 1 trillion. Today it's 12. Where is our own self-government? Why are we not investing in the right thing? Today everybody knows everybody is investing in education and all that. We're not investing. People are telling why the problems we have solved in Nigeria, how can you solve? 60% of the people, children out of school, live in sub-Saharan Africa. 10 million live in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. Yes. You can go and check your records. I saw somebody already. A particular state in Nigeria, Zamfara, let me just call it. In the last year, NECO had only 110 students, only 24 passed. Instead of 5 million people. Yeah. 24. When our state had almost 200,000, for the same amount, it won't work. It's Nigeria. Every part of Nigeria is important to us.
Exactly.
You have to ask that question. Why? What is happening? So when people, when our Nigerians staying here, the investment is critical, but what is more critical? That they become part of the change agent. On top of this type of situation, you still have people like me who are elected. Only in Nigeria, you elect people. People ask me now why we're eating lunch. What is the problem? What is the problem with the people? So only in Nigeria, they elect people. They don't have car, they don't have anything. 6 months, they build their house, buy 20 cars, and call it for Thanksgiving, and people will go there. And they will pray in the church, telling God to bless them. And the bishop will preach in that wherever they got the money, to give them more. When they have the promise. Because they know where the money came from. Everybody knows where the money came from. But they are still celebrating it. He comes to America and buy a house, and he said, you can see his house, and he's in choice areas. When he's in Washington, they're living in this place, this man owns the house there. In New York, this man owns the house there. With whose money?
Oh.
Let him show you his business, his daytime job, that earned that money, in which is Egyptian job, who is doing a advertisement, wants to buy a house in the best area of the world. Let him go and buy it. But for God's sake, why would Peter Obi come and buy a choice area in Washington? When did he own it before? The government built a house that is unbelievable, and they asked, he said, yeah, I used to have the money. Why didn't you build it before? And you want more salary. Even if they had the money before, you would have kept quiet. The rascality must stop. That's what we need to see first. Let's deal with this rascality first. Don't stop this rascality. There's opportunities in Nigeria, my dear people. As for investment, I know you're worried about the country, you're worried about this. Let me tell you, the opportunity you have in Nigeria when it comes to investment is not anywhere in the world. It's not anywhere in the world. I'm sorry to live in America. The reason why I'm saying this is that if you have good managers, even when people talk about borrowing, like our friend has said, it's not your money, you're borrowing. You live in an 18 trillion economy, isn't it? America has 18 trillion GDP. But they're going to 21 trillion. Simple. Even China, when I mentioned, is going 5 trillion. The entire debt of Africa is under 200 billion, which means Africa can borrow more. But who is going to manage this new money we are going to borrow? Is it the same character that is here now? No! So when you're talking about borrowing money, the greatest tragedy your country is facing today is that the managers of the country have never managed anything in their life. If a man has not created wealth or managed anything, they cannot manage public money. You suddenly find somebody who has never seen 1 billion and then throw him and say he's the governor to manage wealth. Go and check it all over the world. All those tribunals went back up.
That's right.
If you give it to Falai, manage it. That's why you say who he is. Telling you everything he told in here is correct. Countries are run today like business. They're managed by people who have managed something. Any manager, people say, oh, Peter, when you went there, what happened? This is that. No, there was no different than the business that I was running. So I know profit and loss. So when I went there, for me, it was a profit and loss. How much do we get? How much are we going to lose? Why should Governor of Anambra State have a lodge in Abuja? For God's sake. This man doesn't live in Abuja. What can I have a lot in Abuja? My predecessor bought it for 800 million. We furnished with 200 million. 1 billion, and we're talking about over 10 million every month to keep this house going. I said, no, what are we doing? It's too expensive. I don't live in Abuja, I'm going over Anambra. I have nothing to do with the launch in Abuja. Shut it down. We have 15 vehicles, 15 in Abuja. 15 vehicles, so 15 drivers. Do you want? Say, listen, we're not governor of Anambra State. And I have 15 drivers in Abuja. How can this be? And people give us the schools that we need it. We even have a lodge in Lagos. Tell me what type of rascality is this? I said, no, it cannot happen. We have to shut all these things down. We don't need it. Because it doesn't make sense. If you go to the world, give it to United Nations. That's where United Nations is since they bombed their place. A year after, I said, no, no, no. Imagine the amount of money sent us every year. I can go on and on. Because we have 30 vehicles, we have a fuel dump. Almost a filling station. For what? Why is it going to have all this cost? You come, if I tell you people the cost of governance in Nigeria, you won't be talking about the president. It's wickedness of the highest level. And people do it. I was just talking to a lady this morning, I said, on top of it, the head office of president. Confusion is that. Do you have an office of president in Florida?
No.
So why is it in Nigeria? This is a 793 billion dollar economy in Florida. I just showed you that one state is six times Nigeria GDP. The governor of California does not have an office of facility. He's the one who should be at home and look after him. Why create additional confusion? If you pass their own set, it's longer than their own man. And this is not in your country. Young man came out here and almost cried when he lost the auntie. Why wouldn't you lose the auntie? It is the resources they will use to build that hospital that they are using to build Convoy. And that is what Salah is telling you. The greatest tragedy, I tell you, is all of you. Because what do people do? I was the governor for 8 years. You hardly meet a Nigerian adult who tell you, you're not doing well. They all call you His Excellency. I tell you that since you came, things have changed. Even when you're seeing that, nothing has changed in your face. Everybody is telling you, hey! And you're the best thing that happens to this country. Nobody could say to you, no, you're wrong.
Yeah.
I was telling them when we're having lunch now, how we change school. When I came, our school were number 20-something in Wayekanleko. Of course, everybody knew that Anambra State, they did not go to school in 2001. And I decided I must visit every secondary school personally. Every secondary, I must go to every secondary school. Everywhere I go, I call parents in the school, call their teachers and headmistress, tell me, is anything wrong? They say, nothing is wrong. I am looking at the school. No, it's wrong. There's nothing wrong. And you see that everywhere is wrong. You see it. Nobody. I went to a school in Asia. One of our towns, and they didn't have a roof. And I promised to give them a check to do that roof because I decided money must go directly to school, not via the ministry, because that's where the problem is. So I told them I'm going to give you a check, 8.7 million. I went there in October. But I said, I'll give you the check before December. The check didn't arrive. In January, I was doing a tour in that local government because in January what I did was to change. When I came, they still had no fish. No fish, nothing. So I decided to adopt MDG other vision and develop a local thing, own strategy for delivery of it, which we christen Anambra Integrated Growth Strategy, which is just a process that a system that allows us to plan properly within the NDG goals, budget properly, execute, and ensure delivery. And to be properly, we change our budgeting, planning, everything from being supply driven to demand driven. So we go to the people. I said, what do you want? In January, I went to the people. And the boss, they don't want to bring school children. And when I finished talking, I said, it's special time. A young girl raised up her hand. And I said, my daughter, probably about 11 years or 12, let me start with you. This young tiny girl gave her a microphone and I said, Governor, why do you make promise you don't keep? The whole hall went to wire. Her principal ran from. In fact, because of how everybody shouted, the girl started shivering. I started like, Mary, she's done the wrong thing. So I heard her, said, my daughter, what is it? She never did this story. I was wrong. I didn't do what I said. And I talked to the commissioner. I said, Commissioner, where is the check? Commissioner said, I said, we must give this girl this check before we leave. The commissioner brought the check. I apologized before everybody. And I gave this girl this check. The principal and the teacher that were shouting at her came grabbed her, carried the girl in their hands. So the people told me that story. So I wanted to understand why I changed from what Dr. Lester said this morning. After the experience, I decided we have to do one thing. That's what Fela told you. I decided that every secondary school, their senior prefect must have my phone number and they must have my phone. You must give me that phone. That's why I collected the phone number of all the secondary school senior prefects. I said, okay, today, you can see SP, listen, all of them, from A to Z. And guess what? You could see how they want change. Every day, there's no day I don't receive texts from 2, 3, 4 of them telling me we have no English teacher, we have no mathematics teacher, our roof is leaking, and this is this. They are sending the same text. You call their brother and say, what is happening? You say, no problem. But you go to see the text from a senior prefect saying, the school is collapsing. There is no teacher. They said, how about the English teacher? He said, oh, it's wonderful. But the children have told you, not English teacher. The principal is telling you, teacher is the best we have in the world. That is what is holding your country. And that is what I'm pleading with everybody. So I said it. You must die anyway. So, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how you die. It is actually better you die doing something noble than doing something wonderful. You need to tell them no. We need to. It is time. Go to little countries and see how efficient their airport, everything works. Yeah. Little things. It cannot work in Nigeria. The reason why it's not working is because you have chosen a young one to die. It is time for us to die. If you don't want to die in Nigeria, hold them when they come here. They won't keep you here. Protest here. Say no to it here. They won't kill you. We cannot go on this way. Obasanjo goes in one and got all our debts cancelled. 2017, 10 years after, we're owing $60 billion to where what we used to owe. What did we use it for? Senator, I just said this before. We were owing that when it was cancelled and we're celebrating. 10 years after, it has doubled. What was it used for? That is the question. Every state today is owing a debt that the next governor can walk. And I said to people, I have been governor for 8 years. We didn't borrow one cup from anybody. I can say that any other person here can testify. We have the best government of any state in Nigeria. As good as the best. Dr. Leo has just told you about Milo. I don't know Milo from Adam. I knew him when I became a governor. He told me he's a heart specialist. That he can do heart operation. We listened to that. I said, why don't you come and do it in Anambra State? He told me there's no hospital where he can do it. I said, you know what you're going to do? Give me the cost of all the equipment you need to do it. And I went to a mission hospital. By the time I completed everything, came to almost $1 billion. I wrote the check. I gave the mission. I said, listen, set it up. If there is working, they haven't operated on me, but they're serious for that people's lives.
I've been there, the biggest brewery in the world.
The best facility they built all over the world is the facility they built in Onitsha. It was supposed to return in 6 years. He paid back in 1 year.
Wow.
The agreement people came from America to meet me, and I can tell you, I know that very well. I invested Anambra State money in it. We own 10% of it. That 10% is the loan over 20 million. So I know that. It's easy. You have houses here. You have opportunities of people raising money here. I lived in the UK for 10 years. For that 10 years I lived in the UK, I was working in Nigeria as well. Then it was easy for me to borrow, I tell you from those people, it was easy for me to borrow money in the UK at 3% and invest it in Nigeria and get over 15%. People will say no about rate of exchange, buy euro bonds. It's dollar to dollar. Today they are 9.5% and you can borrow a dollar for 2.5%. Just for economy, not even invest more. That money will do a lot of good to Nigeria. I'm not asking to, my brother, don't come back. Let nobody tell you Chinese people are still here. Japanese people are still here. But you can be here and be part of that change there.
That's right.
I must say, don't you come back, come back. But don't, the most critical thing Nigeria needs now is to change the characteristics of its leadership. They are the ones that are bringing us this into this insult we receive all over the world. If they don't go about living irresponsibly, and behaving the way they are doing, our country will be better. If our governors can manage the resources of the state better, there's no way a governor can be owing people's salary for 6 and 7 months. But for God's sake, if you can't govern, please. People resign from office here.
Yeah.
You cannot be there using salary and going about when you're owing people. No, you can't say that. I know there's so many things you can do. I can stay here and tell you so many things we did in Anambra State. Some of you have watched my video, how Obasanjo visited us. If you go to Oka, you see it. Every building, presidential lodge, when I became governor, how can you build a lodge for president in Oka? He doesn't live there. I said, how are we going to build it? Why are we going to have a house for India? They say it's in every state. What for God's sake? But what, the president doesn't live in every state. Does every state in America have the presidential lodge?
No.
No. So when do we end this? Does every state have governor's lodge in Washington?
No.
No, they stay in hotel. So when do we end this type of irresponsibility? But they want me to do it in my state. For God's sake, what of us are talking about? I told him, I said, what can I say, Mr. President? You are the president. You have plane come in the morning. What do you mean? No, just go anywhere you want to go, you go. But he cannot. He insists that he will sleep. His best friend, he doesn't insist that he will sleep. He simply said he will sleep. But I have no place for you. But since you insist, you come and sleep in my house. When I sleep and I go away, I sleep somewhere else. When you go, I come back. $1 billion to build presidential lodge. But of course, I just stayed in my own place for 2 nights and it cost me $100,000 in the hotel outside. 2 nights left there. That's what I was told, $1 billion. Since he came, no other president has been there to sleep. I had a house of $1 billion, maintaining it every day, looking at night. When Jonathan wanted to come, I explained it to him. I said, I don't have any place for you to sleep. If you come, you go. If you want to go London, you can come back next day if you wish. But you go to Deborah's state and sleep. And again, he slept in Asaba because they have more money. I do not have it to spend. Ogun State, they have 10 grey proof cars, 80 million naira each. What for them? Nobody wants to kill anybody. Nobody killed me in 8 years. Why would they kill you if you're doing the right thing? So you live with them. Even if anybody wants to kill you, when you come out of that car, they will kill you. You're not going to live inside you. You have a grey proof body. So all I'm trying to point you as I conclude, my dear people, we have a conflict. The first thing you need to do is to say to yourself, all of us must now question the physicality of our conflict. That is our first resolution. Number two is that I urge you to invest. But the first investment is to change the mentality of the people who live there, like the last day, get BBC, tell them who to vote and how to vote, who this is. Number three is bring your investment. You're looking for the best place to invest. It is in Nigeria. There are safe investments you can do. Don't go and give it to your daughter who have never learned how to do business and say it's going to start business. You will take it. You see, we have developed that mentality that is in government. Your foreigner who lives there think that in America there's a tree where you plant dollars. So you must change it by showing him these things have to be properly invested. There's so many safe investments. I have somebody who lives abroad who is making a lot of money from Nigeria. And whenever he says to me he wants to come back, I say, don't come back. I advised him when I was chairman of the bank to put in about $500 million. That money today has so far $1.5 million. He's doing very well. But whenever he says to me, oh, Peter, I'm going to pack everything and come back, I say, don't come back here. We're here. What is important is that you be there and be part of that change. You have no other country. If you do the right thing, nobody, they don't call China shit country. They don't call it Indonesia. They don't even call Philippines. That is the other day. Can look at their face and tell them what you want to tell them and go home. But as long as it remains the way it is today, well, it's so bad. Yeah, we can feel it, can feel the pain, can feel everything. But remember, it is the characteristics of your government that brings such a unit. We have no other country. I'm begging all of you, and I'm joining you, and the younger person, the society we allow them to abuse today will take its revenge on our children tomorrow. Mm-hmm. God bless you.
I'd like the government still standing here. I'm going to call on Ken Shubala and Amelia.
Well, we're doing this very, very quickly because Governor Peter Obi has to leave soon after his presentation. So he has to leave soon after his presentation. And please, if you have questions for him, we're going to go over those now, since he won't be here at the end. So just pass down some little cards. Put your questions on the cards, but we'll have to pick the first four or five, or three or four, in the interest of time. So while that's going on, while you're writing your questions, can the NOC members please collect those cards? And we just have briefly, while you guys are doing that, to fully appreciate the governor for gracing this occasion. You know, it's tough to get people to come here. And not only did he come here at his own expense. Thank you. So we truly appreciate him. We'd like to present this on behalf of the NPR to Governor Peter Obi. I appreciate being here for this inaugural panel. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.